The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord.
The apostles rejoined Jesus and told him all they had done and taught. And he said to them, "You must come away to some lonely place all by yourselves and rest for a while." For there were so many coming and going that the apostles had no time even to eat. So they went off in a boat to a lonely place where they could be by themselves. But people saw them going, and many could guess where. And from every town they all hurried to the place on foot and reached it before them. So as he stepped ashore, he saw a large crowd. And he took pity on them, because they were like sheep without a shepherd. And he set himself to teach them at some length. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus.
So over the last few weeks in our first readings at Mass, we've very much been listening about the trials, the tribulations, the joys, the triumphs of David, of King David, the shepherd king. And we've heard of David as the great saint and also David as the great sinner. And over the last few days, we have heard of how at the end of his life, he was able to look back on it all with gratitude to God for that never-ending guiding hand of God through all his life. There was a deep wisdom at the end of David's days. He could see that, yes, he had sinned greatly, but that was not what defined his life. His life was defined as one who had been blessed and guided by God, who'd been able to be a living sign of God's blessing and presence to his people, to be that true shepherd for which God created, not of sheep, but for his own people. And today we hear that moment when his son, Solomon, he begins his reign, that handing over of the baton, the crown, to Solomon. We often describe Solomon as Solomon the Wise, and that very much comes from this reading that we've heard today. In many ways, this is one of Solomon's finest moments, asked by God himself what gifts he would like or need in order to be a king to his people. He asks for the gift of wisdom, the gift of wisdom, that he should judge and rule wisely, as with faithfulness and justice and integrity of heart, that he should be a worthy successor to his wise father. But first and foremost, that he should reflect the wisdom of God himself. Give your servant a heart to understand how to discern between good and evil. For who could govern this people of yours that is so great? He knows that by his own strength he can't do this. He needs that wisdom of God. And God is so delighted. He's overjoyed. This is a true servant's heart. Because Solomon understands that to be a king means to be a servant. It means to wish and desire the best for your people. It's not about personal power and prestige and glory. It's about service. So what is good for him must be good for his people. So if he can learn to rule and judge as God judges and rules, then he will be a true king to his people, and in image of God himself. Now, in many ways, this is Solomon's finest moment. The honeymoon period does last some time, but when you continue to read the Book of Kings, what we discover, as you remember, is that he is tempted along other paths. He has a great desire for women. He has hundreds of wives and concubines. He begins to forget about service, about everything he has is for the good of his people. He begins to amass wealth for himself. The power corrupts him. And there must have been a deep, deep sadness in God's heart to see one who was given so much, who started so well, who'd been given such beautiful foundations, to see all of that go so much to waste. But of course, God's merciful heart, God keeps on trying. And the continuing story of the Old Testament will be how God continues to invite others to be that true shepherd to his people, prophets and kings, many men and women of noble birth and simple, poor peasants, different voices, different people, calling his people back in different ways to truly be that, to be his people. And then comes that time for the greatest of God's gifts, the greatest of God's callings back to us, which begins with that sending of the angel Gabriel into the home of a young girl in Nazareth, the home of Mary. One of the many titles that we give to Mary in the Litany of Loreto is Seat of Wisdom. In Mary, we see God's true wisdom. There was a natural gift, of course, given to her by God. But we see in Mary, in opposition to Solomon who starts so brightly and then his light fades. We see in Mary one who, through that reflection and pondering all of God's gifts and actions in her heart, one whose natural wisdom deepens and matures. That light of Mary, that like the moon, which always knows that it's not about her, it's about reflecting the light of her son. It's about leading others to Christ and leading Christ to others. In Mary, we see a profound wisdom, that humility of heart, that servant's heart. Now, of course, that always is a heart that points to Jesus. We see in our gospel today just the sensitivity of Jesus. This is, again, quite a difficult moment in Jesus' journey. The apostles have been sent out to preach, to minister. They've come back. They're exalted, all of their successes, but they're tired. And so Jesus, with that servant's heart, always putting the needs of others before himself, wants to lead them away for a quiet time, a time to reflect, a time to be close to God, a time to remember that wisdom of God, that it's not about them. This is about service. Any miracles and wonders that have been performed through them, it's not their power, it's God working through them. And they will need to remember that and learn that lesson time and time again. And there's also a wonderful sensitivity in Jesus' heart, because he knows that John the Baptist has been killed, has been martyred. Now maybe that news has not yet reached the 12, the disciples. And so he wants to take them somewhere where they can be alone and where he can share this news with them. Remember that several of the disciples were, first of all, disciples of John. So for them, it would be like losing a kind of father figure to have lost John. That tenderness of Jesus, which Pope Francis loves to talk about so much, the tenderness of Jesus taking them away for a time to be together, time to be close to their Lord, to be renewed. Of course, as so often, when they try to have that quiet time, it doesn't happen. The people, this great hunger and thirst for Jesus, they follow them, they get there first. And again, another lovely kind of tenderness of Jesus. We hear that he then set himself to teach the people at some length. Now, I'm sure that was because he could see their need, the sheep without a shepherd. He could see the need of their hearts. But also, I like to think that he's also thinking about the disciples in their tiredness. His teaching gives them a chance for that rest, to be renewed, for the limelight to go away from them, and to for them once again to be fed, to be nourished by Jesus. So we see this perfect wisdom of God, of course, in Jesus Christ, his Son, our living Lord. This wisdom that always puts the needs of others first. This wisdom which sees it to the deepest needs of the human heart, not the superficial, but the deepest needs. Now, of course, we are just a few days away from our Lenten journey for this year. Next Wednesday, of course, is Ash Wednesday. And I think these readings are a beautiful seedbed for us, if you like, of the invitation which is Lent to us every year. Something wonderful about Lent in a parish, you really feel it. It brings people to a new focus. There's a new energy. It's something that we do together. It's a journey we make together. We pray together the Stations of the Cross. We follow more closely in Jesus' footsteps. We try to deepen our prayer life individually, but also together. We try to deepen our charitable outreach and giving individually, but also together. So it's an individual journey, but it's very much a journey of God's people being led by Jesus, our Good Shepherd, our Saviour King, who will give himself for us. The very last breath of his human existence, pouring out words of mercy and forgiveness, showing us what it truly means to be a human being made in the image and likeness of God, God who is love, God who is mercy. So let's learn from these readings to reflect about perhaps that Solomon in each one of us. We're created in the loving hands of God. We're created for God's glory. We're given so many gifts, each one of us in our own different way, unique way. But do we like Solomon, if we're going to be honest, do we waste those gifts? Do we too much follow our own ways, our own paths? Is there a self-centeredness, a selfishness in our lives, which rather than bringing glory to God, actually, we could say, does the opposite, it pollutes the world around us. We learn from Mary, that servant's heart, totally focused on Jesus Christ, totally focused on the needs of others. Do whatever he tells you. That's the heart that we need to ask for God's grace to take on again during our Lenten journey, to come back to Christ, to truly walk in his ways, to truly be his disciples. That's the call of Lent. And that means letting go a lot of the things that take us away from Christ, that fill our heart with emptiness and sadness, with jealousies, with resentments, all those things which, God willing, we are bringing to Christ today in the sacrament of reconciliation. It's time for that deep purification and cleansing and conversion. That is the invitation of Lent. And to do it as a pilgrim people, not as individual islands, but as that flock of Christ, to open ourselves up to the needs of others, to be more actively involved in our parish communities, to be living cells within the body of Christ Church, to forgive. And of course, at the heart of our Lenten journey is that imitation of Jesus Christ himself. To recognize that he has come amongst us to show us the deepest wisdom of God, the deepest love of God, the true image of God, which we are to live and reflect to others in the world. Lent is that time for renewal. In many ways, it's a joyful season because we take off those masks, the things that hold us back, and we become free again. I'll just share with you one last little story, one last little experience I had a couple of Lents ago, which I always remember at the beginning of every Lent. I went to a primary school to hear the confessions of the year four children in that primary school. And I went with other priests. It was a big primary school. So there were six priests and we were all around the school hall in the afternoon. We had a preparation, a penitential service. And then the teachers brought the pupils to priests throughout the afternoon from their classes. And it was a beautiful afternoon of grace, the purity of children's hearts, struggling to find something to bring to God, but finding something. And then at the end of the day, the end of the afternoon, when we'd all finished, school bell went, priests were putting their jackets, putting their vestments back in their coats and in their bags. And off we went out into the school playground to head home. And I remember one of the little boys, so about 8 years old, who'd come to me for confession. He came running up to me all the way across the playground with pure joy on his face. It was a wonderful sight. And he said to me, Father, I just want to say thank you. And I said, oh, well, thank you for what? He said, for what you helped me with in the school hall, because I'm me again. What I told you about in there, that wasn't me, but now I feel I'm me again. And he just jumped and skipped off across the playground, laughing his head off. And it was just wonderful to watch this young boy, fully alive, joyful, full of freedom, jumping for joy, because he had become once again what God had created him to be. And that's the invitation of Lent, to become once again what God has created us to be. And we do that by learning and imitating the wisdom of Mary, and of course, most importantly, by following in the loving and merciful footsteps of Jesus Christ, her Son.
Mater Mei.